the search for life in our universe is sort of one of these intrinsic questions to humanity. Are we alone? When we look at Europa, we see that there are ways to exchange chemistry between the space environment and the ocean. There are ways to keep the body warm. There are sources of chemical energy and heat, and all of this has probably been going on for billions of years. So all of a sudden, it starts to look like we maybe in our own solar system have a second implausibly habitable world. And you know, once you have two in one solar system, then they're probably all over the place. Historically, NASA have sent three what we call flagship missions to the outer solar system.
3, 2, 1, we have ignition.
And as we look at that tour and our progress through the solar system, having visited the planets with the Voyager missions and gone to the Jupiter system with Galileo and the Saturn system with Cassini, we're sort of stopping for a moment and going back to Jupiter, and the fourth outer solar system flagship mission, Europa Clipper, is going to specifically look at one of the largest four moons of Jupiter, Europa, to understand if it has the conditions necessary for planetary habitability. Europa is about the size of our moon and most of its rock, but the entirety of the world is covered in about 100 kilometers of water. The top maybe 20 is frozen as solid ice, and then there is a saltwater ocean, we think, underneath that surface. It has a really unique orbital configuration where it interacts with the other moons of Jupiter to continuously dissipate frictional heat at the interior, probably mostly within that icy shell, keeping the ocean liquid and warm. On Earth, we think that a place life might have originally emerged is at hydrothermal vents on the seafloor, where water is swept underneath and erupts outwards to deposit new sources of chemical energy. That sort of gives you one half of the terminal you need for life, and the other half at Europa could be made by the radiation of Jupiter interacting with ices. The real insight it gives you is that you have a second data point where if you find a second emergence of life in your own solar system, you can feel pretty confident and satisfied that it's probably everywhere. The Europa Clipper spacecraft is this large cylinder with two huge solar panel wings coming out. Its solar panel wingspan is just over 100 feet because the sun is much dimmer at Jupiter than it is at Earth, and so you need a lot more surface area of solar panels. On board the spacecraft, we have 9 instruments and 1 experiment that will observe Europa in not only visible light with a narrow and wide-angle cameras, but in infrared and thermal infrared and in the UV, and even with an active source ice-penetrating radar. We'll have in situ instruments that can measure the environment directly. We'll have dust analyzer that can pick up material that's been sputtered off the surface by micrometeorite impacts and taste solid material ejected from Europa directly. We'll have mass spectrometer capable of understanding the rarefied atmosphere of Europa. We'll have a magnetometer capable of understanding the size and salinity of Europa's ocean by its interaction with Jupiter's magnetic field. But all of this is going to happen from orbit around Jupiter with flybys of Europa rather than orbit around Europa. So we're going to make about 50 flybys of Europa orbiting Jupiter. We'll come in as close as 25 kilometers each time. And the reason we're doing this is Jupiter has a very strong magnetic field. Anything coming through the Jovian environment that's a charged particle, like particles from the sun or the interstellar medium, particles erupted off the nearby volcanic moon Io, get trapped and sped up and make intense ionizing radiation. And so it's difficult to keep a spacecraft alive in orbit around Europa because of the radiation environment. So we just dip our toes in and fly out each time. We're going to be exploring what processes we think are active in that ice shell today. Central to habitability in our story for Europa is that the salty ocean interacting with the seafloor could produce a lot of reducing chemistry, and so that's chemistry with electrons to give away. And we believe that the radiation environment at the surface interacting with water and even with sulfur collected like bugs on a windshield from Io as Europa goes around its orbit could produce strong oxidants, so things that want electrons. And all the life that we know of here on Earth uses the transfer of an electron as its most basic energy source for everything from cell maintenance to mitosis, basic functioning. And so what we're really interested in is the place where these oxidants and reductants come together and the two terminals of the battery close. And the surface of Europa is very young, so there's a plausible argument that these oxidants made on the surface are coming down to the ocean. And it's important that we understand, you know, the surface geology and landforms and what those tell us about the exchange of material from the surface to the ocean and the ocean to the surface. We're going to be looking for recent and current activity, everything from where there might be tectonic faults active on the surface today to where there might be eruptions of water vapor from water trapped within the ice shell. We're going to be also probing the interior of Europa. We have an active source ice penetrating radar, so we'll be able to image some structures in the ice shell. If you look at the surface of Europa, it looks like a yarn ball that's criss-cut by slices. There's all of this tectonic deformation going on in the surface that pulls apart the ice shell and pushes it together that's central to material exchange. And so we're going to be looking at how those features extend to depth, maybe even possibly seeing the ocean through radar. On top of that, we're going to be probing the interior of the body by sending a very stable radio signal back to Earth each time we fly by Europa. We can look at the Doppler shift and the radio signal. So in the same way a fire truck driving by you gets really high frequency as it gets close and low frequency as it goes away, as you accelerate flying by Europa, you stretch those waves out or compress them. And it turns out if you build up this web of flybys and you have all of that Doppler data, you can put back really fine detail about how you accelerated around Europa and start to understand its gravity field. So then you can start to understand the distribution of mass in the body and recover its interior structure. This is important because the size of the ice shell relative to the ocean and the deep interior structure all contribute to how we understand the world to be habitable as a system. On top of all of this, we're also going to be looking at the composition of the body. We have, across a variety of wavelengths, the ability to compositionally image the surface at high resolution. And so these are like cameras that take pictures of light outside of the visible spectrum. And the light emitted and reflected and transmitted by the material tells you something about its composition. And so we can survey the composition of the surface. We'll also be looking at the temperature of the surface. That can tell us what tectonic features might be active or where there's shallow subsurface water or even erupting water. We'll be scanning across the entirety of Europa, looking at its edge for water vapor plumes erupting into space. Going upward, we're going to be studying the material coming off of Europa, both sensing the chemistry of particles ejected by micrometeorites and sensing the very tenuous atmosphere by directly ingesting material into mass spectrometers on the spacecraft. We'll also be characterizing the magnetic field around Europa. This magnetic field of Jupiter that makes the radiation environment so intense and makes it difficult to explore Europa is also central to habitability because that radiation environment creates half the chemistry that might be needed for life. But it also allowed us to detect Europa's ocean in the first place. Jupiter has a large time-varying magnetic field, and as Europa goes around it, we noticed it produced a field that was similar to, but offset from, the Jovian field. That we call an induced field. It's the same way a wireless charger on your phone works, where you send a time-varying electrical current through a loop of wire and it induces a magnetic field. You have a loop of wire on your phone and that magnetic field then induces a current. Well, as Europa goes around Jupiter, we notice this induced magnetic field. And similarly, the only way that that could be happening is if there was a large global conducting layer. The most consistent layer that we understand is a large saltwater ocean. And so by sensing the magnetic field around Jupiter and around Europa, we can tease out properties of that ocean, like how salty it is and how deep it is. So all of these processes come together to really help us close this test of the Europa habitability hypothesis involving oxidants produced at the surface and a reducing water-rock interaction at the seafloor being brought together by active geology in this thick icy shell to potentially support a habitable ocean. Having seen it go from really paper studies of how to answer these science questions to hardware that's built and sitting at the Cape with a window opening in October is indescribably exciting. These are missions that are national in scale, or really civilizational in scale, that fundamentally change our understanding of the solar system and our own world. It's exciting to think about what might come next and what might ultimately result in testing a life hypothesis, but I really can't overemphasize how exciting it is to be here in this moment where we're testing the habitability hypothesis, because it really is a new step forward in how we think about the exploration of astrobiology. And so it's this really critical moment where I feel like we're just coming together to ask the questions of what is it we think life requires, and how to explore that and how these processes interact. And they're really hard questions. And yes, it's exciting to think about someday how we would do life detection directly, but the step we're at in thinking about how to close the problem and all of the variety of people involved, I think is just as compelling.